Good morning. It is Wednesday, March the 22nd, 2023. I'm Pearson Bowen. This is the CBC Morning Report. China's President Xi Jinping has signed an agreement with his Russian counterpart Vladimir Putin, bringing their ties into a new era of cooperation as the two leaders called for responsible dialogue to resolve the Ukraine crisis.
They say it's an alliance without limits. China and Russia are expanding trade and diplomatic cooperation. The two countries insist their relations are far from being a military and political alliance. But Xi Jinping and Vladimir Putin share a growing concern of what they perceive to be an American dominance across the globe. For the Chinese leader, who secured an unprecedented third term earlier this month, this trip could be the moment to establish his country as an international peacemaker.
We shall always respect and abide by the UN Charter. We will always promote peace and also promote negotiation and discussion. Our stance is always based on fairness and justice. We will always be on the side of peace. We are always on the side of dialogue. We are always on the side of historic fairness and justice.
But ending war in Ukraine may not be an easy task. China is yet to elaborate on its 12-point peace plan. Beijing has called on Russia and Ukraine to address their security concerns without mentioning Russian troops withdrawal, a key demand for Kyiv. The U.S. has dismissed the peace plan as a stalling tactic. In the meantime, Western nations are stepping up military assistance to Ukraine.
Today we learned that the Minister of Defense of the UK declared he would supply tanks to the Ukraine and also uranium-enriched weapons to Ukraine. I think that the West will now fight Russia to the last Ukrainian.
Facing growing international isolation, Vladimir Putin is turning to President Xi Jinping, an alliance largely shaped following Russian invasion of Ukraine last year. After the EU imposed a ban on Russian energy imports, China stepped in, buying large quantities of cheap Russian oil, providing cash-strapped Moscow with much-needed revenue. The US considers China the biggest threat to its national security and fears Beijing could be exploiting Russia's embattled standing to expand its geopolitical influence.
Meanwhile, Japan's Prime Minister Fumio Kishida is in Kyiv for talks with the Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky.
Well, there's just been a joint recorded statement by the two men following the day visit here of the Japanese Prime Minister. Japan is hosting the G7 in May of this year, so this is an invitation extended to Volodymyr Zelensky. He said he will be attending via video link, as he often does in these kinds of conferences. The Japanese Prime Minister toured Kyiv today, paying respects to fallen soldiers, also visiting Bucha, which is in the northwest of Kyiv, which is a town that really has become synonymous with the potential of very serious war crimes carried out by Russian soldiers during the course of this conflict. So it comes on a day, as you've been talking about, also when the Chinese president, on his second visit, second day of his three-day visit to Moscow, Japan, of course, on the opposite end of the political spectrum when it comes to the two camps, when it comes to pro-Ukraine or pro-Russia. And Japan is someone who's always, a country that's always supported Ukraine with humanitarian and economic means, but not militarily, because that goes against its pacifist charter. But certainly the message from Japan here, first time, interestingly, that the Prime Minister visits, any Japanese Prime Minister visiting a country at war since the Second World War, but is one of solidarity and standing with Ukraine.
You're watching the CBC Morning Report. We're back with more in just a moment.
Because Because you love English Premier League, MCTV has got it back. Now you can watch all the games of the English Premier League, plus UEFA and NFL on MCTV. Current customers can upgrade to Max Pack Extra at just $23. Call MCTV today at 228-6288 to upgrade, or come in and sign up for our new service. Football fans, let MCTV get you back in the game.
Today's Morning Barbados is sponsored in part by Troubadours International. Get ready for the Legacy Show on Saturday, March 25th at Halo Nightclub, St. Lawrence Gap, Christchurch. Sponsored by CBC TV 8 and 94.7 FM.
Community Files.
Learn more about the Met Office on World Meteorological Day at its open day on Thursday, March 23rd at the Met Office at Charnox, Christchurch. View aspects of the Met Office's daily operations while learning about weather forecasts, impact-based forecasting, 3D printed automatic weather stations, better known as 3D PAWS, water level sensors, climate change, tsunamis and earthquakes, and much more.
The Barbados Workers Union leadership says it is stressed with the news of massive retrenchments being on the cards for the St. Lucie-based Arawak Cement Company Limited. The cement plant's parent company, Trinidad Cement Limited, has announced that Arawak is reducing its workforce by 70%, which means over 120 employees will soon be on the breadline. The company says as follows: retrenchment talks with the workers' representatives, the Barbados Workers Union, and the National Union of Public Workers. The parent company also stated that in accordance with the union consultations, the workforce will be adjusted and approximately 30% of the current employees retained in the new operating model. According to Managing Director of the TCL Group, Francisco Aguilera Mendoza, Arawak Cement currently has 175 permanent and casual employees. He said the 70% being retrenched represents 123 employees, while approximately 52 would be retained. BWU General Secretary Tony Moore stressed that this development is very disturbing for the union, as it affects not only the workers but their wider families as well. She says this has been a difficult process.
One of the essential things we practice is listening to our members. And in this situation with the employees of Arawak Cement Company, this is exactly what we have been doing. Since early January this year, the Barbados Workers Union has been in constant contact with the Arawak employees. We've had numerous meetings, some spanning for hours on end. We've been receiving information from the company, ensuring that our members understood it, listening to our members' demands, and representing those demands in our negotiations.
And General Secretary of the NUPW, Richard Green, says his union represents the smaller share of the workers, about 20%, mainly technical employees. He said most of them have accepted voluntary separation packages from the Trinidadian company.
We've had a number of consultations about the way forward with that plant in light of the significant change in the model of the plant and the shift in production away from Barbados. NUPW representation rank relative to how the current staff could be incorporated into the new structure, the new job functions, and the terms and conditions attached to those workers within the new entity. Relative to the proposed new structure, we would have submitted, based on advice from our members, submitted proposals for the new structure and how the dislocation or the separation of workers could be minimized.
TCL issued a statutory information notice published on the Trinidad and Tobago Stock Exchange website indicating that the company's board had passed a resolution authorizing changes in the operating model of Arawak Cement. The cement producing company, which is headquartered in Claxton Bay, said in the interest of its continued viability, Arawak Cement Company Limited suspended its clinker production on March the 15th this year. It noted that the core operation of the company will be focused on the grinding of clinker and cement production. TCL, however, noted that Arawak will continue to produce and supply cement to meet the demand of the Barbados market. Widespread brush fires in recent days have caused a spike in asthma patients visiting at least one medical facility. Confirmation of this from physician specialist at the Sandycrest Medical Center, Dr. Brian Charles. He told CBC News it had been so bad that some patients had to be nebulized.
It has been so bad that a couple of days last week we actually had to send for extra oxygen to manage these persons. On the other side of the coast, which is the west coast at Sandy Crest, we haven't seen any increase in persons with respiratory illness. So that's a good sign. On the west, it's okay, but in Christchurch and St. Philip, we have seen that increase.
Dr. Charles advises that even people who do not have respiratory conditions should stay away from the smoke.
Smoke has irritants in it, you know, not only the chemicals, but particles that when it goes into your upper and lower airways, it can cause irritation. And if you are sensitive, like if you have reactive airway disease, then that can cause problems in breathing. And it would manifest as shortness of breath, cough, and wheezing for those persons who have asthma and who have chronic lung disease. Now, so that's persons who are predisposed. And persons who are not predisposed to this should still be careful because the smoke does cause harm, and it can cause you acute and also chronic effects if exposed for a long period of time.
Well, over the past week, the brush fires have caused the closure of several schools and other institutions. Now, coming up when you join me at 6:30 for Morning Barbados Today, open week at the campus, the University of the West Indies, continues. And so today we'll hear more about the faculty week activities for the CSEC Creative Arts students. If that's you, you need to pay attention. BARP is on the road and BARP is coming to a stop near you. We'll talk to them a little bit about that initiative and what it seeks to achieve. And we continue to update you on what you can experience as part of the Bridgetown International Arts Festival. Those and a whole lot more straight ahead at 6:30 when you join me for Morning Barbados. The CBC Morning Report continues in just a moment.
Community Files.
Learn more about the Met Office on World Meteorological Day at its open day on Thursday, March 23rd at the Met Office at Charnock's Christchurch. View aspects of the Met Office's daily operations while learning about weather forecasts, impact-based forecasting, 3D printed automatic weather stations, better known as 3D PAWS, water level sensors, climate change, tsunamis and earthquakes, and much more. To register for the open day tours, visit the Met Office website at www.barbadosweather.org.
Hey, I am Jaheen Thomas, one of the team leaders of Project SOF. Project SOF is a very transformational program for youth who are now going into secondary school. It helps them with their team building, effective communication,
history has been created at the Derek Smith School and Vocational Center as three students have successfully earned Caribbean Vocational Qualifications or CVQs. It's the first time that students there have completed the examination, and the team at the Jackman's St. Michael Institution, which caters to a range of special needs students, is overjoyed at the accomplishment. One of the candidates is Rashonte Parsons, a quadruple amputee who has been excelling in the kitchen. Rianne Phillips reports.
Meet 21-year-old Rashonte Parsons, a student at the Derek Smith School and Vocational Center. She's a quadruple amputee, which means she has no hands or feet. Nevertheless, she has successfully passed all five mandatory units in the Food Preparation and Cookery Level 1 CPQ. That assessment was completed earlier this month.
At first, it was scary and nerve-wracking, but I had to calm my nerves and don't look at the people that were doing my assessment and just do what I had to do.
Roshante tells us having a career in the kitchen has been a lifelong dream.
My father was a chef, so I wanted to be a chef just like my father, but different. I actually want to own my own business or a restaurant. Mm-hmm. One of those. I'm not too sure yet.
And her mother, Sophia, intends to continue supporting Roshante to make those dreams a reality.
I am really, really proud of Roshante. She has come a far way, and her confidence is through the roof. I know Roshante can do anything that she puts her mind to. Even though with the limitations that she has, one of the key things I can say about her from the time she was a babe, because this is all she knows, since she lost the limbs, she was about 30 months old when she lost her limbs. So Roshante always had the attitude of determination and resilience. And for me as mommy, I just try my best to take a couple steps back and allow her to figure out things, to be an influencer as much as I can be in terms of guiding her positively, biggest cheerleader, and definitely biggest support.
The successes of Roshante and her colleagues are also being saluted by school administrators who are constantly working to ensure all students unearth their full potential.
In the culinary department, there's a lot of repeat work. So the skills are developed and they grow into their true potentials. Yeah, Roshante is one of them. I have seen her growing from strength to strength in the kitchen, kill me off of some of the things that I want to help her with. She said, Mom, I can do this.
We actually have 4 workshops, okay? We have the woodwork, we have the art and craft, we have the agriculture, and we also have culinary, where Roshante is located. All right, so for those 4 workshops, we're actually looking for certification for some of our students. And we're happy to say that we at least have 5 or 6 in each department that we're looking to certify in the next year and a half.
Rhianna Phillips, CBC News.
Pediatric cardiac surgeries have restarted at Guyana's Georgetown Public Hospital through a memorandum of understanding with Gift of Life International. 10 of the most vulnerable patients are the first beneficiaries of the program, but there's currently a backlog of over 100 patients, NCN-TV reports.
Starting today, 2 surgeries will be conducted daily until March 24 to complete the first mission of the organization. Head of the pediatric department, Dr. Tyrick Davidson, explained what the MOU entails.
The Gift of Life will provide all of the technical expertise to conduct these surgeries free of cost on a volunteer basis. And GPHC, through the administration, is to provide to procure the required equipment, medication, consumables, as well as to provide local support from the healthcare doctors and nurses to support the overseas team during these missions, as well as to offset all the other logistics that be associated with getting the cardiac mission executed.
CEO of Gift of Life, Rob Rillman, explained that the organization is the largest humanitarian group to provide cardiac care to developing countries. And with the massive investment by government and expertise from Gift of Life, Rillman is optimistic that the backlog will be cleared.
We are very confident that in the next 2 years we will work down that list of 100 children. It will be done successfully. We have a tremendous rate of successful surgeries. We bring the best of the best from all over the world, and we will work to empower your team to continue to care for the children.
Approximately $60 million was invested to procure equipment for the program. Additionally, 17 nurses and 9 doctors were trained over the last 6 months to build capacity.
Belize is aiming to be certified as a malaria-free country by the World Health Organization. The Ministry of Health and Wellness Chief of Operations Kim Bautista explains that there have been no reported cases since 2018. Certification would help improve tourism and the country's overall image. The government's effort to eliminate the disease through preventative measures, including targeted spraying and education programs, have contributed to the success.
We have gone 4 consecutive years without a local malaria case. So what that has enabled is for us to request from the World Health Organization to do an independent verification of that status. So from February 28 to the 8th of March, there was an independent validation team in country, global experts who had came in to do that exercise, evaluating the surveillance system from the health facility level right down to the community level. So what we are now awaiting determination, which would take maybe a couple months, and that would basically verify what we internally know, that we are at zero malaria. So once a country is certified as being malaria free, what that does is it removes you from any travel advisory as a destination that has that disease. So it's part of the regional project. So we're one of the countries that are basically ahead of the game in terms of the goals of the project.
Let's turn to sports now. West Indies went down by 4 wickets against South Africa in the third one-day international yesterday, despite a half-century from Brandon King at Senwes Park. King's run of ball, 72, included 11 fours and a 6, as the Windies were bowled out for 260 in 48.2 overs. Here are some innings highlights.
The 61 to win, the hosts, led by Heinrich Klassen, raced to that target of 264 for 6 inside 30 overs. Klassen's unbeaten 119 included 15 fours and 5 sixes. Alzari Joseph bagged 3 for 50. The fourth round of the CWI four-day championship is set to bowl off today, with the Barbados Pride up against host Trinidad and Tobago Red Force. The Pride will be looking to put a better showing than they did in the round 3. Anne-Marie Burke reports.
The Pride are fourth in the standings on 31.2 points and will oppose fifth place Trinidad and Tobago Red Force at the Queen's Park Oval in Trinidad. The Pride... Drakes, Shem Holder, Akeem Jordan, Jair McAllister, Zachary McCaskey, Shane Mosley, Rashawn Primus, Joma Warrican, Kevin Wickham, and Rashawn Worrell. The match is set for a 10 a.m. start.
And in more sports news, now the defending a title is always a big task for any sports team. And with the Powerade Dasani Waters BSAT Championships inching ever closer to the finals, the reigning girls champions are looking strong. Take a look.
It's time now for Powerade Dasani Water BSAT back on track, where we have all the action from the secondary school track and field competitions in the lead up to the big final showdown.
Sponsored by Powerade. Feel the power and Dasani Water. Connect mind and body.
The St. Michael School Cougars have sent out the warning. They are ready to battle. Mission is simple: retain the girls' title and reclaim the boys, which they lost to Christchurch Foundation in 2019. No doubt training is a key element of their mandate of being on their A game, but it was not all smooth sailing.
Preparations were a bit slow. I think things caught up with us this year, and we had to be prepared, but not as prepared as we would have wanted to be. Personally, I felt like we were a little bit behind schedule, but things are working out. The athletes are coming together and doing what they're supposed to do, so very good.
Coming out as winners of both the girls and boys divisions of the Frank Blackman Zone is just half the job done, although they have shown to be a strong unit.
I think our team is well balanced. We have some good under 20 girls, under 13 girls, and under 15 girls. The under 17 girls, we have a couple good ones in there. And for the boys, we have a strong under 20. And our under-13s and under-15s should do pretty well. Our under-17s, just like the girls, we have some little ones in there. But I think we have a good all-around team.
Now let's take our attention to our look at forecast conditions recorded earlier at the Met Office, the Grantley Adams International Airport. At the moment, Barbados 25.1 degrees Celsius. Cloudy conditions prevail. The winds are coming from the east at 22 kilometers an hour. If you're heading to the seas today, swells are moderate in open water, ranging from 1.5 to 2.5 meters. A small craft and high surf advisory still is in effect for above normal sea swells. In the forecast, Barbados today, apart from a few brief, isolated, light early morning showers, it will be mostly sunny. And in the forecast for Barbados tonight, partly cloudy with a few brief, isolated light showers. Here's a look now at some forecast conditions for some international cities. Well, that's it for today's edition of the CBC Morning Report. I'm Pearson Bowen. Morning Barbados starts now.
Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Barbados, get up.
Good morning.
Good morning, morning Barbados, good morning.
That's right. Good morning to you indeed, everyone, and welcome to Wednesday, the 22nd of March, 2023. Thank you so much for waking up to keep us company. I'm Pearson Bowen, welcoming all of you everywhere. Thank you for joining us on our streams as well on YouTube and on Facebook and on our website, cbc.bb. Good morning, all. Now, coming up today, we will sit with the Dean of the Cathedral of the Incarnation. He's from New York, and he's in Barbados for a number of engagements. We'll talk to him a little bit about his experience and the subjects that he's attending to while he is here. The Troubadours will be in the house this morning. That's right, they're having their big legacy show this coming weekend. So we want to connect with them, catch up with them, and also preview what you can expect when you attend the legacy show at the Troubadours International at Halo Club this weekend. When we talk HRMAB, HR with HRMAB this morning, we wanted to review the recently concluded HRMAB Strategic Business Partner Bootcamp. How did it go? And as I asked last week, we will get a review from some of those who attended as well. So look out for that interesting conversation straight ahead. We'll also be taking a look today more acutely at indoor air quality, whether that is in your home, in your office, and sometimes outdoors as well, and how that can impact on your health. Well, there is a solution. We will share with you how you can monitor, how you can fix that indoor, outdoor air quality with a prospective client today. Coming up also, we'll continue to share with you what's happening in the Bridgetown International Arts Festival, which is on. There's a big happening at the Barbados Museum this weekend. We'll share with you with those people in just a moment. BARP is on the road again. They're coming to a location very near to you. Why are they doing this? And what are they truly hoping to achieve? BARP will join us this morning to talk to us about the services as they go on the road. Let's get started this morning, though, by continuing our look through the Faculty of Culture, Creative and Performing Arts on the campus of the University of the West Indies at Cape Hill. And joining us today as we look at what's happening with the CSEC Creative Arts students and the programs there, as today's a big day on the campus, is Andrew Millington. He's the head in the Department of Creative and Performing Arts. Mr. Millington, good morning.
Good morning, Pearson, and how are you this morning?
I am well, thank you for asking. How do you do?
I am excited. Because yesterday I got a call from the Ministry of Education and they were confirming the numbers of students that were coming.
Yes.
And they're interested in learning about our programs in music, our programs in theater, our programs in dance, and our programs in film. These have been areas where our creative industries are building and exploring opportunities, really, because these are the pure arts. But essentially, you know, technology is changing things. And we have now to build a critical faculty in students that can take these art forms and take the technology and take us to the next level. That's what we call being globally responsible for our clientele. So today, music, our dean, David Okombo, he is of Kenyan descent, of course. He's going to lead them through, give them some examples of the methods that we adopt. Our theater practitioners are going to give students a taste of the discipline and the care and nurturing and movement of the body and the spirit and the voice and so on. They will see students who have created their own films and beginning to create their own stories and hear about their experiences. And of course, in the dance, if you were lucky last night to see our dance ensemble at the World Poetry Day performance, you would want to send your kids down just to experience it, because the confidence that's built in that exercise, you're going to see how we go about that process today.
And so it's a day today for the students and primarily for them to really come and explore the campus all day long. And in doing so, as I would have heard in the days leading up till now, they have a chance to really go across the different disciplines and get a sense of what is being on offer.
The word is interdisciplinary. That is, you are not fixed on your specific area. Let me give you an example. We have musicians who, a lot of them are focused specifically on performance. But now they can create music for film, or they can create music for a theatrical environment. They can do all kinds of things. Gaming, for example, is being a huge avenue for musicians to create work. So you have to have knowledge of these other areas. How do they work, and how do you take control now and contribute to this growing creative arts? It's a much wider world than you are actually engaging in.
Mm-hmm. So there's so much that one can benefit from. I'm looking at the board behind your head. I see 2x2 equals articulation. I'm sorry, I was like, that's for just a moment. And it's wonderful to know that in the multi and interdisciplinary work approach that you take there, that we get a true sense of the breadth of the creative arts, because that's what it's about. It's more than just performance. There's the business of it, and that's what I wanted to say. Now, talk to us a little bit about the true benefits of the creative arts and study of the creative arts.
Wow. The buzzwords these days are innovation, creativity. It's grounded historically in the study of these areas. In fact, more and more, we were talking about this interdisciplinary thing. Our students are coming from science and technology. You had a fascinating week last week, but they would have begun to understand that technology has to be harnessed if it's going to begin to express our own ideas. So notice STEM, we forgot the A, the R in STEAM. What that is really is bringing a human dimension to what we do. So as an example that I have been given recently, the math students, they're learning code. Certainly when I was coming up, I learned something called Scratch. And what I learned was, this math can be used to create all kinds of different simulations in film. Mm-hmm. There's graphics. There is all these different areas in terms of what contributes to a final product, whether it's a film, whether it's an ad or what have you. But understanding those dynamics, all right, merges art and science. And really, when we think about who we are as human beings, we think science. Almost, we have to consider, questions like, how are we going to deal with sargassum, for example, which is on the news, and how, in fact, can we use images to begin to study what it's actually doing to the environment, what it's actually doing to people's lives, the impact of people's lives. And sometimes art can give us a better idea of what's happening than reading it in a book or reading it in the newspaper, actually. So our lives are tied to that. And when we talk about innovation, we have to see things in a historical context. We have to be informed, and we have to think critically. We have to think creatively. How do we think? The word, I guess, the phrase that people use these days is thinking out of the box. But essentially, looking at our challenges, and ordinary people do this, how can we use our knowledge to face those challenges and actually transcend and create a better world, a better space for the people all around us? That's the idea, really, of creativity, that we're using the culture or our daily lives, our daily challenges, we're facing them, and we're creating a new way of seeing the world and doing things in the world. And that's where that comes from, the arts.
And if you're any way curious about in yourself how you could be a part of this, you should apply to the Faculty of Culture, Creative and Performing Arts. It will bring all of this out in you. Now today then, the students who are doing CSEX will have the whole day for themselves on campus. On Friday, I know you're catering to the Cape students as well.
Yes.
And then tomorrow, Thursday, there's also a very special session. Very briefly, tell us what's happening tomorrow if you can.
There is a panel, or creative arts students because they are so conscious of what's going on around them, are recognizing the anxiety with crop over post-pandemic, and the changes that are beginning to come with that. And they are taking up the mission, so to speak, of beginning the dialogue about how do we sustain this amazing festival? How do we make sure that the continuities that have been built by Calypsonians, by the costume makers, the masqueraders and whatnot, how does that continue to function as we deal with these changes in the world? And that is administratively, that is artistically, that is from every level. Our panel tomorrow night, led by Dr. John Hunt,
yes,
and our students, are going to lay out all the issues that come out and how we can go about sustaining the crop over festival into the future, because this is what they study, not just festivals here. They study carnival in Trinidad, Brazil. They will look at Cuba and Haiti. Mm-hmm. They will look at all iterations, even what we have exported to North America.
Yes.
So Labor Day, this is the study now, because yes, we have to perform it. We have to understand the factors that impact. It's about also making money. How are we going to make sure that source of income is sustained?
Indeed. So it's going to be so exciting. We want you to be there, folks. The Warner Walcott Theatre, right there at the Arrow Barrow Centre of Creative Imagination. Or you can watch it online as well. Andrew Millington, thank you so much for joining us. It is such an exciting time on campus. I really hope that many people allow their children. I'm glad to hear that the Ministry of Education has confirmed that quite a number of coming, and all week long that we do engage with the services offered and the programs at the campus as well. And then you also go online to learn more about the programs and how you can sign up to be a part of it to complete your studies in the creative arts. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. And I just want to say, remember, the creative industries are a future that is bright. Come and explore it and you will see where you fit in.
Well said, indeed. That's the head of the Department of Creative and Performing Arts, Andrew Millington. We'll take a break right here. We're coming back with more in just a moment.
Morning, morning, morning. Good morning. Good morning to you.
Hey, I am Jaheen Thomas, one of the team leaders of Project SAW. Project SOF is a very transformational program for youth who are now going into secondary school. It helps them with their team building, effective communication, decision making, and also raise awareness of drug use. For me, Project SOF definitely impacted my life, especially as a team leader. Dealing with children every day, it was for me to honestly wonder, am I making the right decisions when I approach these children? And not only that, but are they developing as well and taking in information that they're
being? Morning, morning. Good morning. Good morning to you.
We're 16 minutes now to go to the hour of 7 o'clock this Wednesday morning. BARP is on the road. What road and why are they on the road? What is BARP up to? Well, BARP is up to a lot. They're coming to a space near you. Marilyn Rice Bowen is the president of BARP. She's best placed to talk to us about this initiative. Marilyn, good morning to you.
Good morning to you and good morning, Barbados.
As always, good to see you. In true Bajor style. It will be just like, what's going on? What's this thing about on the road?
You know, there's always something going on at BARP.
Yes.
On Tuesday, next Tuesday, the 28th, we are going on the road to meet our members. And the event is called the 7 Seas BARP Members Roadshow. So we are going, our first stop will be at St. George Valley Resource Center. We'll be there from 9:30 till around 11:30. Until 11 o'clock. And while we are there, we'll, you know, sign up new members, allow persons to renew, and also to have that conversation with our members. On the bus, we are going to have members of our membership committee, members of the board, and members of staff. And when we leave the resource center, we're going up to the Eric Holder Municipal Center, and we'll be there from 12 to 1:30 p.m., and our last stop will be at the Belle Plaine Resource Center And we'll be there from 2:30 to 3:30. And at all those venues, we are taking renewals, new membership, and having that deep conversation with our members. As I said, it's compliments of one of our partner Seven Seas. So it's the BARP Seven Seas Members Roadshow. Look out for us on Tuesday. And we've been receiving some inquiries so far. And we do hope that by the end of the year, we would have covered the entire island. But BARP, what we are doing, we are coming to you. We are coming to meet our members where they are.
And prospective new members as well. So it's an opportunity for those of you who do not yet have membership to be able to meet at any one of those locations in any one of those times, to be able to sit with you and walk through the process of application, really and truly. So for those who may not know, what should they walk with to the Resource Center, to Eric Holder Municipality Complex, and the other spaces as well as you hit the road?
All they need to walk with is their ID card.
Good.
And of course, the requisite funds to sign up, and it's $65 to renew, and it's $75. And this is an annual fee, huh? $65 per year for renewal, $75 per year for new membership. What with the ID card, and we are just there waiting, willing, ready, and waiting to meet our members in their own locations.
You know, I cannot believe that there's so many people who are so proud to say, I have a BARP card. It's just so funny because it has a lot of benefits. It has a lot of benefits.
It does. The card, we always speak about the power of the card. The card has a lot of power. In addition to the benefits, is the power of advocacy, because we're over 23,000 strong. You also have the opportunity to access health insurance as well. So it is more than, we are more than just discounts. And our theme this year is Healthy Aging Strong. And so we are hosting events looking at financial health, physical health, mental health. So we are planning programs to meet the needs of all of our members. So BARP is more than just a card.
Indeed, so far more than just a card. And it's wonderful that you're going on the road, because especially in those areas, St. George, St. Joseph, St. Andrew, you know, where people find it difficult at times to come down to the headquarters, you're coming to them. You're making it far more convenient by coming to them at a location that they're very familiar and very comfortable in, so that they can, in comfort, respond and interact with you. So these are the locations, folks. The Valley Resource Center, this is opening on Tuesday. The Valley Resource Center from 9:30 in the morning. Eric Holder Municipal Complex in St. Joseph from noon, and the Belle Plaine Resource Center in St. Andrew from 2:30. BARP is on the road. It's a road show, and it's not a performance show. This is an opportunity to sit down and discuss with BARP and get to know more about the health plan, get to know more about the different services that BARP assists you with and the like, right?
Yes. Yes, indeed. And to meet the members as well. You meet the staff, you meet the board. I get to meet one-on-one with members as well. And that is so important, because we like to engage with our members. So we're coming out to have that deep conversation, and there'll be prizes and surprises. Uh-huh. But as you said, it's not a musical show, but everybody would leave with a sense of gratification.
Love it. I love it indeed. So it's BARP interacting with you, you interacting with BARP. Bring your concerns, bring your ideas, because I mean, let all ideas contend and share with the team from BARP on Tuesday when the roadshow comes to a location near you. And this is just the start, and you're going to be covering all 11 parishes, really and truly. Mm-hmm. And hopefully by the end of the year, everyone has the opportunity, or would have been afforded the opportunity, to interact with BARP. And remind folks, membership starts at 40 years old.
40 years old, so come on out. We're waiting. Come Tuesday, the 28th. Come and let's meet BARP on the road.
Indeed so. Marilyn, I want to thank you so very much. I'm excited about it. I mean, I'm just over 40. Don't say that in. You know, correct. But certainly we want to encourage everyone to come out. Again, let's remind you of those locations. Folks, if we can bring it up. We're going to the Valerie Resource Center in St. George on Tuesday. They will be there from 9:30 in the morning till 11. Then off to the Eric Holder Municipal Complex in St. Joseph. So St. Joseph, look out. They're coming to you there from 12 noon. until 1:30, and then they're driving over to Belle Plaine Resource Center in St. Andrew from 2:30 until 3:30. And so we want all of you, whether you are a member, a new member, you can come and renew your membership, sign up for the very first time, engage with the team from BARP and share your ideas, hear from them as well about the services that they have to offer you. And there are many, because membership truly brings benefit with a card, the BARP card. Marlene, thank you so much. All the best with the road show. And come back and let us know how it goes, okay?
Most definitely. You have a great day. Good morning, Barbados.
Love it indeed. Thank you so much. Good morning indeed to you too. Marlene Riceboy, the president of BARP, talking to us a little bit about the road show, which happens on Tuesday. So be there. We're breaking and we're coming back in a moment.
BARP is on the road. That's right. Tuesday, March 28th, the BARP Road Show in association with Seven Seas will be on the road at the Valley Resource Center, St. George, from 9:30 a.m. to 11 a.m. The Eric Holder Municipal Center, St. Joseph, from 12 p.m. to 1:30 p.m. and the Belle Plaine Resource Center, St. Andrew, from 2:30 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. Become a member, renew your membership, and hear about the benefits of our health insurance plan. Call us at 538-2277. It's the date. Meet BARP on the road, Tuesday, March 28th, when we come to a community near you. Sponsored by 7 Seas.
Morning, morning, morning.
Good morning. Good morning to you.
Hey, I am Jaheen Thomas, one of the team leaders of Project SOF. Project SOF is a very transformational program for youth who are now going into secondary school. It helps them with their team building, effective communication, decision making, and also raise awareness of drug use. For me, Project SOF definitely impacted my life, especially as a team leader. Dealing with children every day, it was for me to honestly wonder, am I making the right decisions when I approach these children? And not only that, but are they developing as well and taking in information that they're being taught? Project SOF also benefits those children, as I mentioned earlier. But one of the major things I have seen, especially from children coming out of Project SOF, is the impact that it has made on them even after the program. Recently, I went to one of the schools where I saw some of these students. And when they came to me,
morning, morning,
good morning, good morning to you.
It's 7 minutes now to 7 o'clock, and I'm telling you, Saturday at the Barbados Museum is going to be fantastic. That's when the Bridgetown International Arts Festival hosts a number of outstanding performances there, and we want you to be there as well. There will be Relon Brown. He is the founder and musical director of the Dominant Seventh Calypso Jazz Band. And also there will be Tristan Haynes, who is a Barbadian guitarist, among those who will also be there. So good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning, Barbados. Good morning.
Thank you so much for joining me this morning. Relon, I'll start with you. A man from Trinidad and Tobago, so you know Calypso well. And you are the founder and musical director of the Dominant Seventh Calypso Jazz Band. Now, for a lot of people, they're thinking Calypso Jazz, that sounds like a contradiction of sorts, but that's not the case at all, is it?
No. Calypso was actually the first, one of the first music to be recorded in the Western Hemisphere, and tremendous influence Calypso has had over the last century concerning North American music and music of the Caribbean. So it's inextricably linked, Calypso and Jazz.
Absolutely. So your band was formed in 2002, but ever since then, you have been finding new ways of representing jazz and calypso. So talk to me a little bit about your journey thus far as a band.
We've had several iterations, still in the Caribbean and Trinidad in particular. Music is a hard sell when it comes to the professional ranks, all right? But today we have a cadre of, or Dominant Seventh happens to be a cadre of some of the finest musicians in Trinidad and Tobago. And so we do a whole lot of different gigs, from quartets right up to full-blown calypso Calypso tent type bands and so on. So we've done the full gamut over the last 21 years.
So on Saturday, when we come to the Barbados Museum to enjoy the performance from your band, what can we expect?
Well, I'm very glad. We're very glad to showcase our original compositions, mm-hmm. and you're going to get a snapshot of Trinidad's landscape. Some of it lovely and beautiful. Some of it not so lovely, you know. But it's a just like Calypso is. It's a commentary in sound. There are no lyrics, but the music and the instruments will talk on Saturday.
But I understand that part of it too is that there's going to be a visual artist who's going to be working along while you perform. Am I right?
No, that actually was that visual artist would have been Janelle Lewis. And last year when we applied to the festival, because of the pandemic, we had to go online. So we actually did a video. Mm-hmm. That would have been aired last year, but unfortunately Janelle can't make it this year. But we intend to paint the lovely images with sound on Saturday.
Lovely, well put indeed. Tristan, what about you? Because you are one of these accomplished trumpeters from beautiful Barbados, having gone through the Barbados Community College and the like, and played with many, many outstanding musicians as well. What can we expect from you on Saturday when we come to the museum?
Well, guitars, but what to expect, I guess, a list of some original music, covers and arrangements of music from here, soca, calypso, I guess, jazz, different arrangements and stuff we do with the music. Yeah.
You started in the guitar and now you've dabbled in a whole host of instruments, but I guess the community college has been able to expose you to so much more. And that exposure also for you came with your playing with a number of outstanding artists. Who are some of the people who you've been a part of their performance?
I have had the opportunity to play with Dr. Nicholas Branca, some Darren Bailey, Ray Holman from Trinidad, Joseph Callender, Waylon Clark, different list of persons and stuff.
Real outstanding artists indeed. What does it mean to you, Tristan, to be on the card of the Bridgetown International Arts Festival? What does that mean to you? We seem to have a stuck situation there. But Relon, back to you. Relon, how did you know about the Bridgetown International Arts Festival? And what do you think it means for these opportunities for artists like yourself to be exposed in these kinds of festivals?
I learned about the Bridgetown International Arts Festival online, on Facebook. And I realized that it was free and open to all members of the Caribbean, right? And so we applied and as we say in local Trinity parlance, we get through.
Indeed, you got through. So this is all happening, folks, at the Barbados Museum this coming Saturday from 1 in the afternoon, and they're going to spend the entire day there. So don't rush the brush. Take your time and come on down. I see they're the members of your band, and could you identify them for us?
Yes, from left to right, we have our drummer Winston Matthew, and he's of Charlie's Roots fame. If you remember David Rudder and Charlie's Roots, he's one of the percussionists on every album. Really excellent drummer. Next, we have Stuart Thorne on an 8-string bass. You all have to come and hear a guy play 8-string bass, right? As if 4 is not enough. I mean, he plays 8. He's really, really good. All right. To my left, you also have Michael Joseph, who is playing double second steel pan, and in this presentation of the Dominant 7 Calypso Jazz Band, we are showcasing the steel pan instrument as an ensconced member of the rhythm section. So Michael has an expanded role on this tour. All right, and the music has a totally different gravity when there's when there's just a steel band taking command. And then finally, he's playing alto sax on this gig, on baritone sax. He's holding a baritone sax, but he's really playing alto sax, Stein Rambran.
Right, this is fantastic. This is all happening on Saturday. Are you already here in Barbados, or will you be arriving soon?
No, I'll be arriving tomorrow morning, actually.
Good.
I was told to mention, it will be remiss of me to mention that live music starts at 3 p.m. on Saturday and with St. Leonard's and Allen School Steel Orchestras. The main stage performances start at 4, and we have 4 hours of performances. And we have an artisan booth. You have a wide variety of things on sale in the lower courtyard, locally made products, beauty and fashion, and so on and so on.
Oh, this is going to be fantastic indeed. In the afternoon at the Barbados Museum, and it's going to be all over the place, really and truly. So let's occupy the space. Let's come on over and support the Bridgetown International Arts Festival. Tristan, I believe you're back now. And so...
Jeez.
Right, so Tristan, are you now too also looking forward to Saturday and all excited to be a part of it?
Yes, please. I think it's a good opportunity for myself and my band to be able to be heard across the island, regionally, even internationally, if you know what I mean. But yeah, I feel it's gonna be a great time. You know?
Your band, who's in your band? How big is your band?
Oh, my band is just my band is a 4-piece. It is me on guitar playing melody, keyboards, bass, and drums.
Just a few of you, but you're going to be big in sound and big in expression as well. And this is happening, folks, on Saturday at the Barbados Museum for the Bridgetown International Arts Festival. A good clash of Barbados and Trinidad and Tobago. Oh boy, Kalalua, cuckoo! This is going to be fun. So we're looking forward to having all of you there. It all starts from about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, live performances, and then at 4 o'clock, the bands and everything express themselves right there. But come spend the whole day, really, at the Barbados Museum to conclude the Bridgetown International Arts Festival. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us. We look forward to coming to be a part of the audience to enjoy your musical offerings, and we wish you the very best. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Barbados.
Indeed, so.
No problem.
See you soon.
As you see there, music is life, and let's live it at the Barbados Museum this Saturday for the Bridgetown International Arts Festival, the Tristan Haynes Group, and more. That more will include Relon Brown, the founder and musical director of the Dominant Seventh Calypso Jazz Band. It's going to be fantastic. Taking a break, we're coming back in just a moment.
Morning, morning, morning. Good morning. Good morning to you.
Hi, I am Jaheen Thomas, one of the team leaders of Project SOF. Project SOF is a very transformational program for youth who are now going into secondary school. It helps them with their team building, effective communication, decision making, and also raise awareness of drug use. For me, Project SOF definitely impacted my life, especially as a team leader. Dealing with children every day, it was for me to honestly wonder, am I making the right decisions when I approach these children? And not only that, but are they developing as well and taking in information that they're being taught? Project SOF also benefits those children, as I mentioned earlier. But one of the major things I have seen, especially from children coming out of Project SOF, is the impact that it has made on them even after the program. Recently, I went to one of the schools where I saw some of these students. And when they came to me, the effect, the impact that I got, because they said, Uncle Jaheen, you know, and to see that that relationship still sticks with them, to see
morning,
that.
Morning, morning. Good morning. Good morning to you.
We're approaching 5 minutes after 7 o'clock now. Health and safety continues to be a great concern everywhere, whether it's at home, at school, at work, outdoors as well. And so indoor or outdoor air quality is what they do. IDQ Caribbean joins us now. Their Chief Executive Officer, Ermin Herman, joins us. Good morning to you, Ms. Herman.
Hi, good morning.
Thank you for joining us. Tell me a little bit about what you do at IDEQ.
Okay, so IDEQ stands for Indoor Environmental Quality. However, we do focus on both the indoor and outdoor environment. Our goal is to identify pollutants, their concentrations, their pathways, their sources, and then to provide our clients with recommendations for correction, all in the overall goal of ensuring health and safety, not only for building occupants, but for occupants of the environment. Mm-hmm. So both inside and outside.
And sometimes we take it all for granted that, hey, it's the air, we're feeling cool, it must be safe. And then we don't understand how unsafe that space could be. And you look at it, as you said, indoor and outdoor. And indoor could be the office, or it could be my bedroom, for that matter of fact. And so what are some of the kinds of health conditions and concerns you think that would crop up indoor that we need to pay greater attention to?
Okay, it varies. It depends on the types of pollutants. What we've seen, especially we've worked in a number of Caribbean territories, mold remains the primary concern. However, we have seen issues with poor ventilation, high volatile organic compound concentration, high carbon dioxide concentration. So we see persons with a range of symptoms, lethargy, dizziness. It can go to heart disease.
Yeah, there are a range of concerns, and that's what we want to focus on. That's what IDEQ offers. So Ms. Herman, you were saying.
Yes. So what we're saying is we've seen the symptoms range throughout. So we have from sick building syndrome, your normal respiratory issues, dizziness, chest pains, headache, and we know that it can become chronic. We've seen research say that persons can suffer from cancers, cardiovascular diseases. So it always depends on the type of pollutants within the environment.
So what does IDEQ do to help me fix this? Really, that's what we want. We want the solutions. What do you offer?
Okay. Before you find a solution, you have to find out what is the contaminant, what is the pollutant, and that's where we come in. Mm-hmm. So we identify them. We do what you call time-weighted averages or short-term exposure limits. So there are guidelines with respect to the pollutants, their concentrations, and what is acceptable both inside and outside. So once you've exceeded those guideline values, then you know we come in with respect to the engineering controls. Are you going to eliminate the pollutant if you identify it? Are you going to engineer your control or administer controls that will help reduce those pollutant concentrations and ensure that persons remain safe?
So it's a full-on scale service that you offer at IDEQ, where you go from assessment to identification and then offering solutions. But do you also assist with monitoring and continued progress all the way through?
Yes, and that's the beauty of what we do as well. We're actually the sole distributors of the continuous monitors by Kytera. Normally, what would happen is that persons would do what you call snapshot analysis, even though they do the time-weighted average. But we found that continuous monitoring helps, and it empowers individuals to take responsibility for their environments. So with the continuous monitors, we say it makes the invisible visible. Mm. So there is an online data dashboard, there's a mobile application, you get alerts once those parameters are exceeded. So you are always one step ahead in an effort to control your environment and ensure that it remains safe.
And that's so important, that we should be that step ahead to avoid the accident of indoor or outdoor terrible air quality. And so given what we've learned from the pandemic, COVID-19 has taught us a lot, but we've grown comfortable again. And your business, IDEQ, is saying, let's not get comfortable or complacent. Let's stay ahead of the curve by employing your services to be able to make sure that we are providing a safe space for work and for play, and to rest our heads as well.
Exactly, because there was this big hoopla about COVID and everybody was sanitizing surfaces, where it was found that fomite transfer was very minimal and it was mainly airborne. So it's not only the virus that is airborne, you have other microbial contaminants that can become airborne. And the gases are also traveling through those air pathways. And you have to ensure that the building and the environment remain safe at all times for your occupants. Sometimes there are immediate reactions, but however, a lot of them are chronic and persons suffer from that 5, 10, 15 years down the line, and they're wondering where did it all stem from. So if we take control now and not relax in terms of our measures, because what we're finding is ventilation is such an important component, especially when it came to COVID-19. Even more important now as persons are re-entering the workforce, persons are no longer at home, so you spend a longer amount of time within that indoor environment. So some of our services, like our Veridat certified program, actually helps you to trace.
There we go again. It'll settle itself down, right? To trace.
Yes, I guess we're back.
Right, to yes. be able to trace.
Right, so we're able to actually trace through the Veridat certified program the concentrations, the dissipation through time, whether your ventilation system is functioning effectively, whether your cleaning programs are effective in creating safe environments.
And this is so critical now, more so than ever before. And so walk us through the process. So we like the idea of IDQ and what you offer. The process of moving from liking the idea to actually signing up, how long does that take? What's involved in doing that?
Okay, it's very simple, actually. We now have clients in Barbados, we're happy to see. It's a simple call, WhatsApp or Facebook message, identifying what your interest is with respect to the services that we provide. We are able to do free, and I quote, and it is actually free. Your initial assessment is free, where we do the walkthrough, identify what the issues are, identify what are some of the contaminants that may be impacting your indoor or outdoor environment. And then we provide you with a proposal with the costing for the testing. Very simple.
Very simple. And you can go online and you can register at the website IDQ Caribbean, IDEQCaribbean.com. That's the website. You can begin the process of the consultation, talking through and making arrangements as well to be able to do so. And you said you're in the Barbados market as well.
Yes, we're a registered company in Barbados. Mm-hmm. We were registered in August and we have started operations in January.
This is fantastic. This redounds everybody to our benefit, truly, to take hold of this service indeed offered by IDQ. IDQCaribbean.com is the website. Reach out to them today because the quality of the air we breathe impacts the life we live and the quality of services that we offer as well. So if you want to be able to reduce the number of sick days and so forth, if you want to attend to providing a safer environment for our people, we have to be able to do this. IDQCaribbean.com, start it today. Get that relationship going and let them come inside and do the assessment for you, which is free. And then you'll have that discussion as to how we begin to put systems in place to reduce or fix whatever has been the concern. Ermin, thank you so much for Ermin Herman, the Chief Executive Officer of IDQ Caribbean. Thank you so much for offering the service to us and engaging with us this morning on Morning Barbados.
Thank you for having us.
You're very welcome indeed. Ermin Herman is the Chief Executive Officer of IDQ Caribbean. Now you know, now you do. A break, and when we come back, we're talking HR with Hermap after this.
Morning, morning, morning.
Good morning. Good morning to you.
Morning, morning, morning.
I am Jaheen Thomas, one of the team leaders of Project SOF. Project SOF is a very transformational program for youth who are now going into secondary school
It helps them with their team building, effective communication, decision making, and also raise awareness of drug use. For me, Project Solve definitely impacted my life, especially as a team leader. Dealing with children every day, it was for me to honestly wonder, am I making the right decisions when I approach these children? And not only that, but are they developing as well and taking in information that they're being taught? Project Solve also benefits those children, as I mentioned earlier. But one of the major things I have seen, especially from children coming out of Project Solve, is the impact that it has made on them even after the program. Recently, I went to one of the schools where I saw some of these students. And when they came to me, the effect, the impact that I got, because they said, Uncle Jaheim, you know, and to see that that relationship still sticks with them, to see that they still remember everything, because they were like, Uncle Jaheim, you coming out watch me? You gonna watch me run? That is important. And I believe that it is in those moments that it really helped us not only sustain, but safeguard our future today.
Good morning, morning, morning.
Good morning. Good morning to you.
17 minutes now after 7 o'clock as we have what is for me my favorite segment on a Wednesday morning. We're talking HR with Hermab, and it's right on the cusp of a big, big event they had recently. Joining me is the president herself, Joan Underwood, along with two other boot campers, her and Caroline John and Gabrielle Francis. Good morning, all.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good.
Thank you so much for joining us. Joan, I hope you've had the rest, because it was quite a boot camp from what I saw.
It was indeed. You know, when you lose rest, you never catch up, really.
Never.
But I said, someone asked me, how do you feel? I was like, I'm exhausted, but so gratified. It went off exceptionally well.
I've seen so many wonderful stories coming out of it, and it really pleases me to know that we've been able now to not just shine the spotlight on HR, but to be able to shine the spotlight in such a way that we see the true benefits thereof. And so talk to me a little bit about what happened in that boot camp, and because I want a report.
Well, I brought along two boot campers so that you can hear from the persons had, not just the organizers of the event. But one of the things that stood out for me, and I want to thank CBC and Morning Barbados in particular, because I think you played a pivotal role in this, is that we saw a lot of non-HR practitioners show up for the boot camp. Mm. And I think that's because they've been following us in Let's Talk HR, and they realize just how important HR is. So the majority of participants were non-members, but we had a lot of enthusiasm about applying for membership, and we had strong representation from a designation that was coined during the boot camp, which is HR Curious.
Oh, I love it. I love it. One of who is Caroline John. Caroline, good morning to you.
Good morning, Pearson.
Now, like you, I'm an HR practitioner, but I'm curious too. So I'm sure that led you to be a part of it. What was the experience like for you?
Well, it was an exciting time. I would rate it as phenomenal. And as Joan said, I am not an HR practitioner. I was one of several of the attendees that aren't HR practitioners. And I think what caught my attention, not only that I was curious, because as she said, that phrase was coined at the boot camp itself by one of the centers. But I was always curious about this field, this practice of human resources, being that I am somewhat into people management, but, you know, HR is wide ranging. Mm-hmm. So I saw the flyer and I saw all of the topics listed. And I was curious and I said, this will be HR focused, but obviously it's wide ranging. You have topics like law and finance. And so I said, you know what, this is the event to attend. And so I approached my management and they said, yes, for sure, we'll cover the cost.
Nice.
But the event was amazing. It was amazing.
Nice. So what did you come away learning or knowing more about you and about HR, the practice of HR?
Well, as I said, I realized that HR is wide reaching, and it relates to, it's really the cusp of it all. I mean, when you think of management and people management within any organization, how can you not have an HR practitioner? And I came away realizing that HR in organizations, they're not as valued as they ought to be. And so I'm really thrilled to be a part of, I'm thinking of taking up membership with HRMAB, and I hope that they offer it to non-HR practitioners because, it's a pivotal role in any organization. And that was one of the things that I came away with. And the presentations were phenomenal. Phenomenal. You had a presentation from PricewaterhouseCoopers on managing finance. One of the things that I took away from that is how instrumental finance is to HR practices. And you would think that it only relates to accounting, but without the numbers, the HR managers I learned cannot make decisions that would relate to the business strategy of the organization. That's one of the main things that I took away.
Oh, I could see on your face how excited you were then, how excited you still are. Yeah. Keep the energy up. Keep the energy up.
Thank you.
Gabriella, about you now, because you're relatively young into the practice of HR yourself, and so what did the bootcamp do for you?
Well, the bootcamp really opened my eyes about the various areas in HR. Because I was always HR curious, and I always used to say, okay, I want to be an HR manager, I want to be an HR manager. But the bootcamp allowed me to see that there are so many different areas in HR that one can go into and make a wide difference in any organization.
So of all of the presentations over the day and a half, which one stood out for you as the one that you thought, oh my goodness, this was truly eye-opening?
As Caroline said, my eye-opener was the Lisa Moore one when she was talking about aligning the numbers with HR. Because a lot of people might think that HR doesn't have to deal with numbers. That would be like in accounts or the financial controller job. But really and truly, HR has to look at the numbers, to go to the CEO, to ask for training for staff, to ask for compensation for benefits, employee engagement. So dealing with the numbers aspect of it was my favorite part of the boot camp.
You're relatively young in HR, you know, and sometimes you just thought, let me just learn from experience. But now you've had an opportunity to have a somewhat formal experience now from this training as well. What advice would you give to others who are new to HR who are just not so sure how they should proceed their career?
I would tell them to join HRMAP. It is a network, and I believe that you should have a strong network system, strong support system when expanding your career. And HR seems like HRMAP seems like the great place to start.
Joan, it must feel so heartwarming to hear these two young ladies speak in the way they have spoken about HR and about HRMAP and the services that you offer. How do you now feel hearing from them, those who attended the bootcamp, about the bootcamp?
Listen, we could not have asked for better. I mean, the extent in the room was amazing, and to read all the posts and get the feedback. And so for those who were at boot camp and you haven't completed your evaluation form yet, please remember to do so, because our commitment is to continue to serve you and to take that service to an even higher level. So it is so gratifying, Pearson, and to see that the appeal is not isolated to one category, one area of HR, but that people are developing an even deeper appreciation of the diversity that exists within our profession.
Indeed, and you know, I keep saying it, I would have said it after every segment, membership comes with benefits. And you would have heard Gabrielle talk about the network, the support that is offered. I want to appeal now to those who are now hearing it perhaps for the very first time and thinking, I should have been there. I really should have been there. Those are second thoughts. Talk to them a little bit about why they need to join HRMAP, why they need to join the network of HR professionals.
Yes, it can be very lonely in HR, right? Because you're sort of caught in that zone between senior management and the staff, where the staff think, oh, they're more loyal than they are to us, and management may perceive that, oh, they have more the interests of the employees than they do of the organization, which actually is not the truth. But how do we then convince people and to show them how much value we as HR practitioners bring to the table? It's by bringing persons together to have this kind of dialogue rather than talking amongst ourselves. And so, I mean, someone like Caroline added so much value and will continue to add. So for those who missed out, because we did get that feedback in terms of people who were disappointed, they weren't able to make it. We had people who registered and then something happened at work and they couldn't get to the event. And so I spent a lot of time over the weekend thinking about, okay, how can we bring them into what, as you've heard from the ladies, was such a phenomenal experience. And what we've decided to do at the Committee of Management is to open up the Hoover platform to the broader audience. Before, it was restricted to persons who had registered for boot camp. But within the coming weeks, we're going to open up the platform. And why is this important? Because you get access to that amazing network. Mm-hmm. And folks are really sharing. They're sharing articles. They're sharing experiences. They're talking about different payroll packages, how it's been working out for them. They're asking questions and getting answers from subject matter experts and people who have been in the career longer. And so we're going to open that up. In addition to the networking, when we open up the Hoover platform, persons will get access to all the handouts from the event. So okay. While you missed out on the live event, the resources are amazing. I myself was bowled over by the generosity of the Pillar Champions in terms of the resources that they shared with us. So we have a new product, which is called Bootcamp Lite, because it's not the full bootcamp experience, but it will give you access to network that's there. And it's not just a national network, it's an international network, as well as the fantastic resources, frameworks, and other tangible products that you can begin to use immediately, thanks to our generous Pillar Champions.
And all of this will be via the HRMAP website?
Well, it will be via the Hoover app, which we will link up to the website now that we're opening up, but it's going to be restricted access because membership does have its privileges. So either you become a member of HRMAP or you purchase the Bootcamp Lite access, which will give you access to the Hoover platform exclusively.
Fantastic. As always, I'm very proud of all the work that you've been able to do so far through HR and to stimulate the interest in human resources management and practice as well. And so the bootcamp has truly been a success. I wish you and your organization, Joan, all the best with your other plans, which I'm sure that you will reveal to us or will be revealed to us in time. But in thanking you, Joan Underwood, President of HRMAP, I'm also thanking today Caroline John and Gabrielle Francis, who are two attendees to the Strategic Partners Bootcamp hosted by HRMAB, HRMAB. And so we want to wish them much success in their future endeavors through HR. We're going to take a break here. We're coming back to meet the troubadours in just a moment.
Morning, morning, morning.
Today's Morning Barbados is sponsored in part by Troubadours International. Get ready for the Legacy Show on Saturday, March 25th at Halo Nightclub, St. Lawrence Gap Christ Church. Sponsored by CBC TV 8 and 94.7 FM.
Barbados, get ready for The Troubadours Live, Saturday, March 25, featuring DJs Admiral and Wayne Cool. $80 at the door, or get your tickets at $70 from Emerald City Six Roads, Carlton Supermarket BlackRock, Smart Stores Land Rim and Welch's, CS Pharmacy Broad Street, New Look Boutique Robert Street, DigiSouth Sky Mall, Lucky Horseshoe, Warriors, Worthing, Bangatown and City Centre, Abbeville, Rockley, and online, TicketPowCaribbean.com. Troubadours, Wayne Cool Simmons, Admiral International, Saturday, March 25, Halo Night Club, St. Lawrence Gap.
The facts say Morning Barbados reaches an audience of over 50,000 and Newsnight reaches over 56,000. It's simple. When you advertise, you're getting your message to over 50,000 of your potential customers. Make the call to CBC Sit Department today and watch your business grow. Contact us at 467-5559 or email marketing@cbc.bb.
While you go about your business, we go about our business, and that is gathering the news. Stay up to date at CBC News.
Get ready for The Troubadours Live, Saturday, March 25. Featuring DJs Admiral and Cool. $80 at the door, or get your tickets at $70 from Emerald City Six Roads, Carlton Supermarket BlackRock, Smart Stores Land Rim and Welch's, CS Pharmacy Broad Street, New Look Boutique Robert Street, DigiSouth Sky Mall, Lucky Horseshoe, Warriors, Worthing, Bangatown and City Center, Abbeville, Rockley, and online, TicketPowCaribbean.com. Troubadours, Wayne Cool Simmons, Admiral International, Saturday, March 25.
Morning, morning, morning.
Good morning. Good morning to you.
Wayne Simmons just told you when, Wayne Simmons told you where, Wayne Simmons just told you how to get your tickets. Why? We're going to one sensational night. It's a legacy show by Troubadours International, and two of the oldsters are here with me.
No star. Oh.
Did he say oldsters?
Yes, I did.
Just so, he just breaking just so oldsters. I won't even say senior citizens. We are two seasoned citizens.
You're absolutely right.
Thank you.
Agree with you.
Scorbin
is his name.
Oh boy.
Who doesn't know Ken Jones? Who doesn't know Ken?
Good morning. How are you doing?
Absolutely doesn't know you.
I don't know him. If you know the things I know about him, I don't know Ken Jones.
Listen, when one thinks of great music and great musicianship in Barbados, one has to say one word, the Troubadours. And that must mean a lot to hear that over the years, eh?
Yes, been a legacy, you know. We've been around for a long time. Actually, really, I guess the oldest band still performing in the Caribbean.
Wow, that must mean a lot for you, Alps, to know that you've been around for so long.
See,
attacking me again.
No. That's true, because, and the part is this, I'm from the second generation Troubadours, okay? Troubadours started back in, I would say, 1963. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to get an answer from Ken Jones exactly when the band started, because I know his mom gave Ken, when he was about 12 years old, a set of drums, and gave his brother Sidney a bass guitar. Mm-hmm. That's when the band started. And we had guys in the band that joined the band from Top Rock. A lot of members from the band came from Boys Foundation School.
Well, that's all right.
I know you didn't go in there. So it being back in, so 63, we actually started the same year as CBC TV. Did you know that?
Around that time, yeah.
CBC Radio.
Yeah.
CBC TV started in 64. Don't test me out.
You can give me in trouble for a year.
Yeah.
that's where the band went. And we have been going around for all these years, performing all over the world, in Canada, in the United States, all through the Caribbean. Yeah. And it's a great honor to come home to Barbados and play for this show. We didn't actually give ourselves the name of the show. Somebody gave us the name.
Oh, really?
The Legacy Band. Because to me, Barbados has other legacies and Troubadours. Like Garfield Sorbet's a legacy, but Ken Jones a legacy? Yeah, right. Al Scorbin? Yeah, nah.
So this show on Saturday night is, I suspect for a lot of us, is going to be fantastic.
Yes.
Because we know you for your horns. I mean, when you think Troubadours, you think the sound.
Yeah.
And the brass, how clean it truly is.
We horn lots of people, yeah.
Yeah. And so... This man is going to mess me up this morning. And so that's what we're looking forward to on Saturday. So talk to me a little bit about who, by the way, where did the name Troubadours come from?
Oh, that was given to us by a priest, the late Canon Jones.
Yeah, Ivor.
Ivor.
Mm-hmm.
He gave us the name. He's a wandering musician. So he gave us that name because his son was also playing the band.
Ah.
Yeah.
Angela, his daughter, I know her well. Indeed, this is fantastic. So over the years,
we are blessed.
Yeah. But over the years, you've been able to work with not just the original artist. You've brought in some other people. I know Adrian Clarke at one point.
Many people.
You know, Mike Thompson and the others as well.
He's still with us.
Yeah, Mike is still with you.
Yeah, Mike will be singing Saturday. Mm-hmm. We're actually going to perform as the old troubadours of old. We can stick with our old troubadours with Raymond Blake and their fantastic, our arranger Raymond Blake. And a fantastic saxophonist, Prince Cave.
Yes. Yeah. Call that name, you know what happens.
Yeah. Or Prince could blow, let me tell you. So, and we can stick to that core of members in the band. And this year, normally we would come in here and have other people sing with us. And, you know, you would have Shane Forrester and Kim Derrick. A lot of people sang the band. Mm-hmm. But this year, this is Troubadours carrying the full show on Saturday.
Sweet. This is really, really good. I'm excited already about it. I know many people
you're
are
really excited. Well.
I know you're coming, man.
People always say they're excited, but they don't really mean. So are you really excited?
I don't use words I don't mean.
Really?
You know that about me.
I sort of know
I
that.
I don't use words I don't mean.
But hold on. I use words that I don't mean myself, but I'm really excited.
Well, that's
I'm
your expression.
That's exciting.
But trust me, when I say it, I mean exactly what I mean. And so Saturday night is going to be one of those nights not to be missed, for sure.
At the Halo.
At the Halo nightclub.
Which is the old shipping. It's very nice venue. Yeah.
It's a beautiful venue. And so it's going to be a beautiful venue for the Troubadours Legacy
and
Show.
What we're doing also is that we are wearing uniform like back in the time when bands used to dress. So we're not coming up t-shirt and you know, we just come in like how it used to be.
But that's what how you remember the Troubadours dressed well as a performing band. Right. You take the business of the performance very seriously.
Right. Very seriously.
He wants to say something.
Come to see us, but stay. You come to see us, but you stay for the visual. Understand? That's what we are. And I'll tell you something. This show would not have not been made possible if not for a few people, which is very important. You know who's on board that really made this show happen?
Tell me.
BTMI. Mm. Because they recognize that Troubadours is a band that toured. We had a lot of people that came, going to come in from Canada and the States. So and in St. Lawrence Gap, they go, whoa, this is a tourist thing. They came on board. BTMI, the Plumtree Club came on board with us. CBC TV actually came on board. A lot of sponsors that no one knew before.
Clyde Jones Limousine.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Troubadours traveling in style.
Is going to do it. They're doing the video
film.
Sean Hope Insurance.
Sean Hope Insurance. And we're giving away also a staycation for two from Infinity on the beach.
I hope it went up.
Me too.
But that's a door prize.
Yeah, that is a prize for real, honestly. So you got to get to the box offices very early, folks, and get your tickets if you don't already have them, because this is going to be one of those shows, again, not to be missed. Come for the fun, stay for the uniforms. Just get it out. You know, and that's the whole point. But can you give us a sense of what's the you said is there, you're playing your original repertoire and so
everything
forth.
Everything we're playing.
Everything you've done.
Reggae, spooch.
You know, I like talk. I love talk.
Talk and
that's
time.
Absorbing second name. Talk. All I can do is talk. I was saying to some guys just now, I am not that fantastic of a musician, but I could talk, let me tell you. So they told me this Saturday night, they said, Alps, no big say a long talk. So I've been governed down. You can come here to music. And if you want to know what we are playing, you want me to tell you the whole set?
Not the whole set, but
okay. We started with some spools. We can play talk, nice time. And we can have actually this. We do have wearing sunglasses. We rehearsed last night. I'm tired as heck.
That's all right.
So we are, this year, we can do something where we try to feature the horn players as much as possible.
Nice.
So Raymond may take a special solo, Prince Gabe will do something. That's what we're going to do. We can go back to the old time way of Troubadours. It can be a good time. I hope I'm
nice
there.
Nice time for you.
It can be a nice time. Nice. Yeah.
Fantastic time as well. From Ragga Funk to Garrett Bowles.
You know them songs?
If I don't listen, you need to listen to 94.7. If you listen to 94.7, you listen to me. For sure, those songs will play.
Don't get testy.
Sorry, sir. But I'm just saying to you.
That Ragga Funk, that's Kenjo's favorite tune, you know?
Yeah.
Sweet man.
And the girl that sings on there is
Betty Payne.
Betty Payne.
I know these things.
Come on, man.
Well, I'm glad it time because I know these things myself.
Well, no, you know. And so, folks, if you want to know, it's Saturday night. Yeah. Is that what time do you start?
The doors open at 8 o'clock, mm-hmm. but get there early, you know.
Yeah, you better.
Because also you have the Admiral.
And, yeah, cool. Simmons.
I mean, you know, two top DJs back in time,
mm-hmm.
you know, and we're going to have a nice time.
We're going to have a nice time indeed. And it's at Halo Nightclub in St. Lawrence.
The old shipping
building. If you're just unfamiliar with the name change, that's exactly where they're going to be. Yeah. And it starts early o'clock, and we want you to be there earlier o'clock to find your park and find your space and find your own little corner, but come in your large numbers because this is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. And what I love about the Troubadours is that you guys have kept together. You know, their bands have gone apart.
There's a reason for that.
And what's the reason for that?
We know too much about each other.
No, we have been through like
a lot
together. We had a fire where the van going to New York to play for Independence, November, mm-hmm. caught a fire, passports burning, clothes, shoes, everything, my instruments burned.
Mm.
We were on the side of the road for 8 hours. Until we got rescued in the cold November.
My goodness me.
The van has turned over with us, instruments. You know, we've been through
a
Christmas
lot.
Day.
Mm-hmm.
We used to play 48 weeks a year mm-hmm. in Canada. And Christmas Day, this was all the family we had.
Whoa.
Stuck in a hotel.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So yeah. We get a little testy though. There's something. We don't really fight among ourselves except when it comes to music.
Yes, yes.
That's the only thing we fight about. Other stuff.
But we're very close because of this.
Very close.
I could call them guys tomorrow and say, y'all want to do a gig? Or it's like.
And it's like that.
And we never even asked how much the gig paid.
Yeah, irrelevant.
Which reminds me, how much the gig paid?
That's you're so crazy. But because it's paying a lot to us.
Really?
It's paying a lot to you to be sure that we're there to be a part of it. The doors open early o'clock, folks. Don't miss it. Do not miss it. Do not miss it at all. So you have to go today to the box offices if you haven't already done so and get your tickets early. There's a fantastic door prize. You're going to win a staycation at the outstanding Infinity on the beach. You're literally at the edge of infinity. You see forever thereafter once you're there staying at Infinity on the beach. And it's going to be just one of those amazing nights never to be forgotten for once in your life if you haven't already done so. And this is now an appeal to our younger audience as well. If you've never seen them live, you know, just yesterday I was asking a colleague of mine, a youngster, mid-20s, I said, have you ever heard of the Troubadours? Who? I said, are you kidding me? So when I began to call the names of songs, yes, I know that song. I said, well, that's the Troubadours. Have you ever seen them perform live? Obviously not. So this is an opportunity for the younger ones to come to see great performances from great Barbadian musicians live at Halo Nightclub in St. Lawrence Gap on Saturday night. Get there, get into the box offices now and get your tickets if you haven't already. Let me be able to say sold out. I'd love to be able to say that.
TicketPal.
TicketPal is one place
online,
as well.
You can buy online.
Mm-hmm. Or you can do like me, pay at the door.
I'm like you.
I hope I get a free ticket, but I think I got to pay at your door.
Pay at the door, man.
I pretty much paid for every restaurant that I go to, the Troubadours make me pay.
So, folks, we're going to the Troubadours. It's a legacy show. It's for one night only. It's going to be sensational in truly indeed. And so I want to thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Corbin and Ken Jones.
You know, from the Troubadours, the real Troubadours, they're going to be there, and we shall all be there real as well. Thank you, boys.
Thank you.
You're very welcome indeed. Morning, Barbie. This takes a break right here. I'm going to have to compose myself because the Dean is going to be here to talk to me in just a moment. Back in a bit.
Barbados, get ready for the Troubadours Live! Saturday, March 25, featuring DJs Admiral and Wayne Cool. $80 at the door, or get your tickets at $70 from Emerald City Six Roads, Carlton Supermarket BlackRock, Smart Stores Land Grove and Welch's, CS Pharmacy Broad Street, New Look Boutique Robert Street, DigiSouth Sky Mall, Lucky Horseshoe, Warrens, Worthing, Bagatelle, and City Center, Abbeville, Rockley, and online, TicketPalCaribbean.com. Troubadours, Wayne Cool Simmons, Admiral International, Saturday, March 25, Halo Night Club, St. Lawrence Gap.
Today's Morning Barbados is sponsored in part by Troubadours International. Get ready for the Legacy Show on Saturday, March 25th at Halo Nightclub St. Lawrence Gap Christchurch. Sponsored by CBC TV 8 and 94.7 FM.
Morning, morning, morning.
Good morning. Good morning to you.
Community Files.
Learn more about the Met Office on World Meteorological Day at its open day on Thursday, March 23rd at the Met Office at Charnox, Christchurch. View aspects of the Met Office's daily operations while learning about weather forecasts, impact-based forecasting, 3D printed automatic weather stations, better known as 3D PAWS, water level sensors, climate change, tsunamis and earthquakes, and much more. To register for the open day tours, visit the Met Office website at www.barbadosweather.org.
Hi, I am Jaheen Thomas, one of the team leaders of Project SOF. Project SOF is a very transformational program for youth who are now going into secondary school. It helps them with their team building, effective communication, decision making, and also raise awareness of drug use. For me, Project SOF definitely impacted my life, especially as a team leader. Dealing with children every day, it was for me to honestly wonder, am I making the right decisions when I approach these children? And not only that, but are they developing as well and taking in information that they're being taught? Project SOF also benefits those children, as I mentioned earlier. But one of the major things I have seen, especially from children coming out of Project SOF, is the impact that it has made on them even after the program. Recently, I went to one of the schools where I saw some of these students. And when they came to me, the effect, the impact that I got, because they say, Uncle Jaheen, you know, and to see that that relationship still sticks with them, to see that they still remember everything, because they were like, Uncle Jaheen, you come in and watch me, you come in and watch me run. That is important. And I believe that it is in those moments that it really helped us not only sustain, but safeguard our future today.
Barbados.
Morning, morning, morning.
Good morning. Good morning to you.
We're 13 minutes now to go to 8 o'clock. Have you ever wondered when you put two deans together, what happens? We brought two deans together right now. The dean of St. Michael's Cathedral, the Very Reverend Dr. Jeffrey Gibson, and with him is the Very Reverend Dr. Michael Sniffen, who is the Dean of the Cathedral of Incarnation in New York. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Dean and Dean.
So,
Dean Gibson, I'll start with you. Why is he here?
We have been working together at least over the last year, sharing information, ideas. But this year, Dean Sniffen is on the island to conduct a series of retreats at Codrington College. Mm-hmm. And we have also invited him to deliver the annual Dean's Lecture, which is coming up this Thursday evening. Mm-hmm. So it's a dual purpose, really.
So it means a lot to have the twinning of the two, the Cathedral of Bridgetown, of St. Michael and All Angels, and the Cathedral of the Incarnation. What's that? Can you give us a bit more insight into that relationship between the two cathedrals?
Well, the cathedral in Bridgetown, we have the St. Michael Center for Faith and Action, mm-hmm. which is a local charity which looks out for people in general. We promote public education of religion, the care of the needy, and the provision for people who have needs. The Cathedral of the Incarnation, interestingly, they have a spirituality center. And out of that, we have been able to gain some insights as to how we can work together to further our own ministry. And Dean Sniffen is here to help in that process. We have been doing conversations online, mm-hmm. and we've also had, well, he had a visit here last year, so we've had interaction personally before.
Dean Sniffen, welcome back to Barbados, first of all.
Thank you.
A young man offering himself to the ministry in the way that you do, and obviously spirituality means a lot to you. What does it mean truly to you, so we understand?
Absolutely. So, you know, irrespective of people's religious background, we all have an innate human spirituality, which is that light within us that helps us discover our purpose, mm-hmm. who we are, how we relate to other people and the world around us. So I spend a lot of time using the riches of the Christian tradition to help young people connect with that sense of purpose and belonging.
And that's so important today because we feel as though we're drifting a lot. And so this, the purpose while you're here is to be able to help us drift back to who we are. In doing so, you've also been having these retreats at the Codrington College, talking to the seminarians, I suppose. What has that experience been like so far?
It's been wonderful. I mean, not only are we interacting with the seminarians at Codrington, but we've had people online from across the province, so from all over the Caribbean, and primarily talking so far about this this notion of spiritual imagination. What is it that's enlivening people in terms of their connection to their deepest self, to God and their community? Been a very rich time.
That's the, I was used the word dangerous, but that's not the word I meant to use, but that itself can be open to so many things. If I use my imagination, I could come up with whatever I choose to come up. I might not always be good.
That's absolutely right. So what we're always doing is connecting our imagination with the history and the tradition of our religious practice, and then coming up together as community with what do we think is going to be most life-giving going forward.
Interesting. You're here to deliver the Dean's Lecture as well, and you're looking at the topic, the spirituality of the city. Not the spirituality in the city, the spirituality of the city. Why is it phrased in that way, and what do you hope to be able to share with us?
So, you know, we're coming up on Holy Week in the Christian tradition, and so Jesus, you know, heads towards Jerusalem and says to Jerusalem, you know, the city that kills its prophets, how I wish to gather you under my wings like a mother hen. And there's this sense that cities have unique cultures. They have unique focus of how they spend their energies, and they have their own spirituality. And so how do the clergy and the churches speak into that, and what do the clergy and churches have to learn from the city in terms of how we move our people forward in love?
And what people also learn from the city, because at the time in the Bible, you know, that's where they all gathered, not just for censuses and the like of it all, but that's where the courts were, the justice was dispensed, and a whole host of things. And it was always ringed by this strong fence. And so there was something special about the city.
Yes.
And within that was where spirituality lived. And that's the symbol for a lot of people of spirituality as well. And that's what I suppose you'll be bringing out in the lecture too.
Absolutely. And I think you've said it so well. The spirituality of the city is unique from the spirituality of rural areas or villages. And the energy is different. And the way in which people come together is different. So that's what I'll be talking about on Thursday. And in part, a large amount of it will be about my experience in ministry in Brooklyn. So a different city, different kind of population, different energy, but lots of commonalities.
What do you see to be the commonalities?
So, I mean, I think urban areas on islands share a lot in common. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about the spirituality that we discovered recovering from a hurricane in Brooklyn, where a lot of the low-lying areas of our city were devastated. And I know that's something that, you know, Barbadians understand very well, that in the aftermath of disasters, sometimes our spirituality is highlighted. Our connection to one another and the earth seems deeper. And I think that's a rich area for contemplation.
This is Dean Gibson. This is fantastic. I mean, no, I'm curious. Where is it going to be, by the way, the lecture?
This will be in the Courtney Blackmun Grand Salle on Thursday evening at 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock.
And, yeah, it's open to all persons. We have particularly invited leaders in the city, religious leaders in the city and other persons. But there's also a general invitation to everyone. And it's also going to be streamed. And so it should be available online, Facebook, and YouTube.
Yes, for those who can't make it. But I think it's such a critical area of discussion. I'd love to see more Barbadians really show up and be in the Grand Salle to hear from Dean Smith Sniffen. I teased him about his name earlier on. But would it be the sort of lecture where it's participatory, where we can talk to you and you can help us clarify some of our misconceptions or our own conceptions?
Absolutely. And there'll be quite a bit of storytelling as part of my lecture, and also talking about the unique ministry of cathedrals, which are places that are very open to questions, very open to people discovering who they are in God. So this is a conversation that Dean Gibson and I have been having, but we want to share more broadly, not only with our congregations, but with the general public.
You know, you take me back again to the Bible story where Jesus, as a little boy, went up to he was in the synagogues, he was reading the scriptures and the like of it, and to be able to show the value again of the cathedrals and the places where people can come and learn and find rest, find answers, and find peace within at the same time. And so you're going to draw the distinction between the city and the rural areas and the way that spirituality either are either similar or different?
Yes, absolutely. And the notion of sacred pilgrimage, right? Mm-hmm. That even people who may go to a parish church that's much further out in a rural area, the idea of coming in and out of the city and the way, how is that affecting your soul work that you're mm-hmm. doing? And what do you bring back from the city and what do you bring to the city mm-hmm. from your experience?
We're all called to be soldiers. We're all called to mission. That's interesting. That's right. No, I'm going to be in the audience. I could feel
other people there
having questions as well, because you're stirring the imagination, you're stirring the intellect, you're stirring the spirituality within as well to dig deeper, to look again at oneself and one's purpose so that you can better understand your value and your reason for outreach. And so it's happening on Thursday in the Grand Salle. And it starts at 7.
At 7 o'clock.
It's going to be online as well for those of you who are unable to make it in person. And so I want you to really be a part of it. Now, while you're here, Dean Sniffen, what else are you going to be doing apart from just Codrington College? Is it all church?
Is it all church all the time? No. Clergy are human beings. So we'll be having some good food, perhaps taking in some good music.
It was
wonderful to meet your previous guests.
Yes.
And also meeting lots of people. You know, I grew up in a small fishing village in mm-hmm. New York, and so spending time around the water and people who work on the water is something close to my heart. So
yes.
I want to meet as many people here as I can while I'm on the island.
This is fantastic. You know, remember thy creator and thy youth. And here it are, you're one of those examples of that. A young man, strong in his faith and hitting the pavement, doing the work that has been set to him to do. What does it mean to you? How long have you been now serving as a minister of the church?
I've been a priest for 16 years, so I was ordained very young. I'm one of those who came directly through college and right into the priesthood. And so although people who work in industries, you know, at my age maybe aren't considered young, I'm quite young in the church world.
Yeah.
And I think looking to the next generation, you know, who are not just our leaders in the future, they're already leaders, and encouraging and empowering their life of faith is really my passion.
And I'm glad you said it that way, because I want young people to see that this is also for them. This is not just the ministry alone, but this lecture too is for you, so that you could perhaps see yourself in this as well as Dean Sniffen has. And so he's given his life, you can too. But give your time on Thursday from 7 o'clock in the Grand Salle or online, if it's more convenient to you, to the lecture by Dean Sniffen. And he's going to be looking at the spirituality of the city. It's a great discussion indeed. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me this
evening. He will also be in the cathedral on Sunday morning at 9 o'clock. Delivered a sermon on Sunday morning, 9 o'clock.
Sweet.
It's St. Michael's Cathedral.
St. Michael's Cathedral, All Ages, 9 o'clock.
So to speak.
Love it indeed. Dean Jeffrey Gibson from Barbados and Dean the Right Reverend Michael Sniffen from New York. Thank you very much, gentlemen. All the best and enjoy the rest of your stay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll come right back with more in just a moment.
Good morning
to you.
The facts say Morning Barbados reaches an audience of over 50,000 and Newsnight reaches over 56,000. It's simple. When you advertise, you're getting... Barbados is sponsored in part by Troubadours International. Get ready for the Legacy Show on Saturday, March 25th at Halo Nightclub, St. Lawrence Gap, Christchurch. Sponsored by CBC TV 8 and 94.7 FM.
Morning.
So don't forget, you need to get your Easter bonnets created and ready. Get ready to send those photographs in as well. So be as creative as you possibly can. Find your hat and fix up your hat to create your Easter bonnet. So take a picture or a video and you will send us by email at morningbarbados@cbc.bb, morningbarbados@cbc.bb, or you can send it by WhatsApp to 467-5465. You get a chance to win $250 in cash. And of course, the winner will be here on Morning Barbados as well. So get cracking, get going. Whatever age, it does not matter the age. It's not just for little children, it's for adults as well. So we encourage you to be crafty and creative and get your Easter bonnet together and send them in, picture or video. pictures and videos, you can send to by email to morningbarbados@cbc.bb, or you can send them to WhatsApp 467-5465. Thank you all for participating. Good luck to all. Well, that's it for today. Thank you so much for joining us. My producer has been Nadia Foster, technical director, Roel Ford. At sound has been Michael Sobers, and at master control, Tamisha Green. My makeup technician is the one and only Joanna Jones. I'm Pearson Boyne. For all of them, to each of you, thank you. We'll see you tomorrow. Take care. Bye-bye.
Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Barbados, get up.
Good morning.